So.
Thanks, Marcus, for introducing me. I was told I can also give a formal talk on a puppet camp, so yeah, I'll do so. It's about Foreman letting Foreman pull your puppet strings, so I want to show you how to get Foreman on top of your probably already existing puppet environment. So who am I? My name is Dirk Götz. I work for Netways as a senior consultant and trainer, being mainly active in two open source projects. So it's Isinga and it's a Foreman project. For Foreman, I did several years ago a training that is available as open source. So if you need some guide to learn Foreman, you can find it online. I'm also in the monitoring team now. So we created a monitoring integration for Foreman. Yeah. Today's agenda is I want to shortly introduce you into Foreman. Yeah, it can be only a puppet dashboard. Some time ago I did a talk that Foreman is not only a puppet dashboard because it typically should at least use also the provisioning features. I want to show it provides an API and CLI I want to shortly introduce. I want to give you some ideas what you have to keep in mind when you want to roll out in an existing environment. So focusing on the Foreman itself, the smart proxies. I will explain the agents, so the puppet agents in our case, and what to do with the puppet DB. Then I want to show some additional plugins. Depending on the time, I can easily extend this list and can extend the time I use for the plugins. I think we won't have so much time, so I really won't shortly introduce them, so you have an idea what you can all get and extend Foreman. So, Foreman itself is an open source project. It's meant for lifecycle management for servers. So it should really be the case you start your servers by provisioning some with Foreman. It hands over to a configuration management. So in the beginning of the Foreman project, it was only Puppet. Nowadays, you have the choice. It should be afterwards orchestration. So everything running the system in the end, and they call it monitoring. Also, being a monitoring consultant, I would call it reporting. So everything done by Foreman or tools integrated in it, send back reports so you have a nice looking dashboard and get all the information from one central interface. For this, it provides the web-based UI you typically will see, or at least I will show you, API and CLI. It integrates other tools with a component that is called Smart Proxy. I will talk about this later. And this tool is now located at Netways, at Red Hat. The company is working on and so on, but it's really the base for Catello. It's a plug-in for Foreman that adds to this lifecycle management, also software management, so you have your local repositories. And this is also what the enterprise product Red Hat Satellite 6 is. So yeah, you see it's really enterprise scale. As I said, I want to introduce you into the Puppet dashboard capabilities. So it can do what you would expect. You see the reports of the Puppet runs, you will get the facts, you will see an ENC. So my slides are only my guidelines to my demos. So I'm here to fail my demos again. This is what you get. If you log into Foreman, you get some nice dashboards telling you in which state your systems are. So in my case, I have one that is running Puppet fine, one out of sync, so it failed to send a report in the last 30 minutes, and one that has never sent any report. So it tries to give you all the information about your configuration environment as easy as possible. For the reports, you can go via the monitoring and get all the reports, or going via one specific host. In this case, this one is the ones that reported in time. You can change the search query, so you can also add something like, I won't only see eventful reports, so it will only show reports where something happened. Just to show you the things, so I have run here my puppet agent some minutes ago. It was uneventful, so I switch back to this view. I see the same. And they really try to do this in a nice way. Let's make something, or let's destroy something. So now my Isinga Web 2 would have lost its external authentication. My puppet one should fix this. You see, the report you get typically only if you are on the system. You heard in the other talks, no one is watching the reports, is looking in these reports if they are in the puppet DB, because this is meant for some, okay, perhaps it has not fixed something, it failed something too. Let's have a look, because typically you won't run puppet on the system and will have a look on these reports. This is why I really like performance capabilities, so I should have gotten a new report now, and I can see here something was applied, something failed. So this would be an eventful report, and typically if you go to the dashboard, you see, okay, there was some systems with a change, and you get all this, all this what you typically only would see if you run puppet in verbose in the front. And it also can do it quite nicely. So here, a file was changed. You see everything in these reports. Another thing it does while running this report, it uploads the facts. So you can go via this monitoring or via the single host. And then it depends if you got here to this view from one host, you see only its facts. If you go via this monitoring, you see every fact, every host. So I could have a look and, okay, I want to see all my operating system facts. So two systems only in my small demo case here, and they both report back CentOS. It also tries to visualize such things, so we have our statistics. Here I have a nice, even environment. So it's only CentOS 5. I have seen this using about 100 colors because the distribution of the operating system versions was a bit more diverse than in my demo case. And yeah, it really tries to present it as nicely as possible. There's also the possibility, it does not make sense in my demo environment because it needs a constant flow of data, so we can have trends, so it's really helpful in migration cases, like, okay, I want to move from Puppet 3 to 5, and I see all my Puppet versions in a trend, so every 30 minutes a cron job will run, will get this data, will move them to the database, and you will see a graph. And yeah, it helped me in some environments. I was migrating Puppet 3 to 5, and always when I thought, okay, now I should have had all them, again, some Puppet 3 systems, till I find out that one department always deployed, again, Puppet 3 instead of 5, that they were told to do. Yeah, this is something you really need, this dashboard features. Another thing with a graphical UI, you can get less trained people, like your operational staff or my trainees can easily add a new system. With provisioning, I will show you this in a second, but it's really important that they can tell Puppet what the system should be. So you have this Puppet role profile pattern, hire for the data, and do this everything in Git. This is one possibility. You can do this all in Foreman, so you can create your Puppet environments in the Puppet system and then simply import your Puppet environments and the classes contained in it. Yeah, okay, my cache is not really fresh. You can really configure it so it ignores your library modules and you only see your profiles or your roles. So it depends on how you want to do this. You have the complete choice between going all the Puppet way, all the Foreman way, or something in between. So in my demo case, I said, okay, I don't want to spend too much time on it, so I won't do the parameterization of the things. I only use my profiles. So I ignore all the other things, so it does not get too confusing in the UI. I import my profiles. I could now simply update it, and yeah, I would have gotten a new class. Just showing it here. The newly imported one is the one assigned to NoHost. It's my hardening profile. Okay, I won't use it in this demo, but now it is here. And in this case, I thought I use this config groups to build from my technical profiles my roles. So I have my one monitoring master. It contains two classes, is assigned to one host. I can use syslink, so it is assigned to this host. And just to show you how this would look. Yeah. It's always the same if you run demos like this at your local system. They tend to be a bit better performing in a data center. So in this case, my Puppet classes, I could assign the individual classes or I could assign this config groups. It is just added. You see the classes included in it. And of course, I could do parameterization with it. So in my case, my profiles do not have any class parameter. But yeah, if I would have them, I could easily change them as a default or here for one specific host. And in the end, there is the ENC script, which will typically give the give Puppet this YAML output. So if you're firm with it, you will recognize here the classes. You see my profiles basic and my profiles monitoring class, Puppet environment, production is set from Foreman and so on. And it adds many values you simply get from Foreman because it knows about it is from the provisioning that will be there available as global parameters. So you can use them also in your Puppet code. So this is what I would say, this is Puppet dashboard functionality. This is something I expect from every Puppet dashboard. But Foreman adds more to this. It adds several ways for provisioning, so you can simply do a pixie boot. Yeah, okay, this is perhaps not so impressive. I show you that it is really done good in this way, but you can add more. So with compute resources, this is the integration of cloud providers and virtualization platforms. You can create your virtual machine from Foreman, and then it will do a pixie boot or an image-based installation. There's a discovery image you can use if you cannot do pixie at all, or if you want to have metal as a service installation, simply boot this discovery image. It will get this hardware into Foreman, and then you select it for the Pixie boot or for an image-based installation, what you have prepared for it. Also, for those that are not able to get all from the network department, they are not allowed to run Pixie. There's this iPixie integration with a boot disk, so you get a boot disk to boot your virtual machine, your physical machine from, and it will simply start up enough so that it can be configured from Foreman for provisioning. Yeah, it's also in some computer resources integrated, so you get this boot image automatically uploaded and attached to your virtual machine, and it boots from it. It uses ERB templates for this, so you can have really complex logic in your templates for this installation. I just want to show you on for this one, I prepared my Pixie template. So with the review tab, I see it with all the values added. Via editing, you can see the original one. So you see it is much more complex because it's getting so many values and adds some to this command line. And this is an easy one. This is Pixie boot. This could look much more complicated with the provisioning templates. As you see here, much more value calculation, and there are snippets. So you can move configuration out of one template to include it in multiple, so you don't have to create your SSH setup, your Puppet setup, in one case for this system, for this operating system, doing the same for the next, and so on. Simply use a snippet, and you can have the same Puppet provisioning for the initial Puppet provisioning, installing the Puppet agent, and so on, for every operating system in the same way. What you also should keep in mind, provisioning only the system is not enough. With the Foreman, you have the possibility to integrate additional services via the smart proxy. I don't need Wi-Fi. So what you at least want to have is DNS for the deployed system. So you want to be able to log into the system. But you can have also more things. I have my slide on the smart proxies, but keep in mind, for Pixie, you need TFTP, DHCP, DNS, and so on, and everything of this can done with Foreman in one place. So you don't have to create your thing here, add this service later, and so on. So you can do this all with this nice graphic interface I showed you, but there's also an API. It's a REST API with a JSON body. It's based on IDs. This is what perhaps is not so nice. So you have to really to do at least two runs with the API. The first it will give you the ID and then you change it. So there's also a CLI. It's a separate Ruby framework they use for it. It's called Hammer. And this is also ID or name based, so I can really recommend this if you need some automation of your automation. And also CLI and API are extensible by plugins. So if you install a nice plugin, it will add to the UI, but you will also get all these possibilities the plugin is providing via API and CLI. So for the rollout, at the open source camp on Puppet, I expect most of you are already using Puppet, but perhaps not everyone is using Foreman. If you want to change this, there's a nice tool. It's a Foreman installer. It's a CLI tool. It will keep an answer file, so you do not have to remember every time what parameters you have sent to it. In the last one, It simply uses Puppet modules and some hooks and so on. So it does a bit more than only using the Puppet modules. But because of it using Puppet modules, if you later want to have also your central Puppet server puppetized, you can do so quite easily. It can cover different scenarios. So one would be, of course, our central Puppet master. Others will be our smart proxies. There are also different scenarios like, okay, I don't want to have only Foreman, I want to have Cartello, so I want to have a much bigger feature set on my central system. Everything is here easily available, because if someone adds to the Puppet code, the Puppet modules from Foreman, it will show up in this Foreman installer. So I do it this way. I just show you this installer. Okay, probably first we'll have a clue that it will be bigger when I pipe it to less, because it has many, many options. You see, this list is extended with every module, with every plugin. So probably you don't trust it to run sys and having the right answers on an existing system in the first time. This is why I recommend this one. So I think the last ones won't see it. It's Foreman installer --- no op, so no operation. Don't save answers, so it won't save an answer file, so you can play around with it. And they're both, so it is not simply showing you a loading bar, it will show you everything it is doing. So in my case, it hopefully does not change anything. What I typically do is really run this, see what would be done, what will be changed by the Foreman installer. And then I can tweak the answers so it really simply runs and shows me everything it would change on the system, and I'm pretty sure that it won't break it. So yeah, as you see, it's a Puppet run, it is applied in some seconds, Puppet has finished, then it executes additional hooks. One is showing you how to get in the system. It's a random password, and I already changed it, so don't try it. Typically, if I have a single Puppet master, I run this on this Puppet master, just adding more, like our Bastel freak mentioned, a Puppet master can easily grow. If I have a bigger environment, so I have multiple masters already there, I typically say, okay, I do not add this to one Puppet master, or of course you can add it to multiple systems for redundancy, but then I really recommend you run this on a separate host, get a dedicated system for Foreman, or perhaps two if you want to have the database on a separate system. And what it is only doing to your Puppet server is it adds the ENC script, so you get a script that uploads the facts and gets the ENC data to Puppet, and it adds a new reporting functionality, so the reports are uploaded to Puppet. This is the only thing it changes. It perhaps changes some permissions, because you will make your Puppet master a smart proxy. So the Foreman UI will talk via this smart proxy. It's a component that knows about the service underneath, and it has a secure communication for Foreman. So it's simply Foreman talking to this API, and this smart proxy knows how to manage the service underneath. So with the Puppet integration, you get two features for this smart proxy infrastructure, smart proxy. Yeah, I have to hit the button. So my smart proxy here, it is up and running, communication is fine, it has many features, I see the logs, so I don't have to go to my smart proxies after I installed them once typically. So the Puppet integration, you have seen it in action because I imported the classes already. And yeah, it tries to give you information about only this one. So you can have multiple Puppet masters, so also different with different environments. And if you have a problem with only one, it really will recognize which one. You can see here that this one is problematic because every host that uses this Puppet master is failing, or nothing is distributed there, and so on. And it also integrates the Puppet CA functionality, so you can manage the certificates, you manage your auto-sign entries. So in this case, I could revoke my certificate. Perhaps I shouldn't do. I can add auto-sign entries, also a wildcard if someone needs. But Forman is doing this during provisioning. So if I tell it to provision a system, the first time it connects to Forman in the provisioning template, it will automatically create the auto-signing entry and will remove it in the last line of the manifest when it tells Forman that the system is completely provisioned. So this will get this quite easily. No. But there are other features for this smart proxy. So you can have multiple services in one smart proxy. There are multiple providers for one service. So implementation varies. Typically, they use the API, but there are some wired things like you want to manage DHCP on Windows. There is also an implementation that does this with a Windows CLI tool. So you have to run the the smart proxy on a Windows system. There's also now an implementation that does this with the API. So it can really depend on if you need the smart proxy located somewhere central or really on the system. Yeah, it provides a secure communication. So typically it's not a problem. It's an advantage that you can do this. So find what you need for features, deploy them how you need them. So if you have an DMZ or you have customer environments you are managing from your center system, just deploy the smart proxy in this environment and have only one communication you need. This can also be done with a Forman installer. So tell the Forman installer to not to install Forman, to not install a Puppet master, just to install the smart proxy and configure it for handling Puppet CA, Puppet, or TFTP, DHCP, DNS. So for example, if I go here, create host, and I say, okay, I don't want to the automatically generated name. Let's say I want to have my demo CO2. So I'm a lazy admin. I prepared already a host group that provides enough defaults. So I tell it, this will be a bare metal system. It will be in my Puppet production environment with a Puppet master assigned, Forman, and the Puppet CA Forman. So it's all on the same system in my case. I could also tell it, instead of using bare metal, to use my virtual machine. I could do so now, but it will perhaps be over my 30-minute time limit. You see, if I select deploy on my libvirt machine in this case, I automatically get a new tab for virtual machine, and I can then create my virtual hardware. I'll switch back to bare metal. Oh, I'm already over time. You see, I can decide on the architecture, define my interfaces. In this case, I have to provide a MAC address. It automatically suggests a new IP address. And because I do not have Overworld. I've played too much, perhaps. So I now would be able. No, I have a problem. So in my case, I already prepared, of course, one. My demo 01. Localhost. It automatically creates this DNS record. I will have a DHCP lease, will have my TFTP, so vollip TFTP pixie boot. So I get my DHCP reservation and so on. I have used the same MAC address probably. For the agents, you do not have to change anything. They will automatically created by the reports. I recommend using this default host group plugins that automatically assigns a host group, so the system is really managed. You can do this if you already have your Puppet system running. Every host will have this fact file on it. You can run node ab push fact, so the ENC script will upload all facts in one time, and you get all your hosts created, and you can easily manage them from Foreman afterwards. PuppetDB is not used by Foreman. There's a PuppetDB plugin you should install if you want to use PuppetDB. It will do node cleanup and integrate the PuppetDB bash board, so you can see how PuppetDB is performing. If you want to get rid of it, replace the PuppetDB query with the Foreman function, and simply PuppetDB query is also a faster way to work with PuppetDB than using the exported resources. As I said, I will not have enough time for the additional plugins. I recommend at least having one remote execution. A boat provider is not here already, but this allows you to do ad hoc tasks, schedule tasks. It's also using ERB, we'll get all this. Marcus is not telling me to stop, so I only want to show this fast.
I can slowly fade away the sound.
So I schedule a remote job. I have several categories. In this case, I want to just run my Puppet run once, so everyone can see that it really is doing something verbose. And it is pending, and the jobs will start, and I always have the possibility to have a look into and really get live the output from the job runs. So this is what I really like. This was the first solution I said, this can I use for updates without being locked in the systems and having all the terminals for it. So there are many more things that you can make it a distributed log manager, make it a lightweight CMDB, integrate monitoring, create your own plugins. So it's really a nice and extensible thing. I talked about most of those plugins already in other talks, so just look up my name and Foreman and you will find other talks showing this. It's nice, flexible, enterprise ready, can and will be improved. Further documentations, I will have my slides online, but look at the Foreman documentation. It has a manual for Foreman, for all the plugins. Find our training material, it's based on our GitHub account, or just dive into the Foreman community. They have this discourse, a nice platform for discussion, and they provide a YouTube channel with deep dives, community demos, and so on. Thanks for your attention.
By the way, Foreman is now real enterprise too, because the developers are working for IBM. since they bought Red Hat.
Yeah, perhaps in the next one I will have a blue helmet instead of a yellow one.
So one or two questions maybe? All already on Foreman?
Ah. This is why I'm always overtime with my demos, so no one tries to ask questions.
Okay, so we have appliances for DHCP and DNS. How well does Foreman handle that with the smart proxies?
It depends. So there are many, many providers. I think DNS and DHCP are those with the most ones because there are so many solutions for this. I'm not sure because it is not mentioned. And also, if you would mention, I'm not sure if there are also the provider, but there are providers for many appliances, for many different DNS solutions. So Power DNS, Route 53, so the AWS DNS, you can manage every one of this. And it's really quite easy to, if you have some knowledge of this API, to extend it with a new provider for these services.
Okay, thank you.
Basically, if your appliance has an API, it can be integrated. Yep. Good. So, thank you very much, Dirk.